So earlier we talked about preference commodity bundles and how a preference relation becomes rational. We also talked about something called strict preference and another kind of relation, which is indifference. Today we start with utility function. Utility function, which will allow us to represent that same preference relation via some numbers. Okay. So in consumer behavior, the preference relation is often described by a utility function denoted as U of, technically speaking, we write it as U of x1 comma x2 because we work in a two commodity world, but in general it must be written like U of some x, where this x is basically a vector. Okay. So just look at the definition. What is the definition? A function U maps from some X to R, R means real line, is a utility function, representing preference relation R if for all x1 comma x2 belongs to X, or maybe we should write capital X here also, here and here, belongs to capital X. X1 or X2, that is X1 are related to X2, or X1 at least as good as X2, implies and implied by U of X1 greater than or equal to U of X2. Okay. So even when we are writing like this, at the same time we are actually, when we'll be doing our work, will be representing it like this. So for example, if I want to write the same thing in bivariate structure, okay, or maybe we should write it x comma y, that's better. For all x comma y, so it's better. Xy, u of x, u of y, where x is x1 comma x2 and y is y1 comma y2. Why we are writing like this? Just not to forget that whenever I am writing x or y inside U, basically I am talking about a two component vector. Okay. At least. So all of this can be written in n commodity also. There is no issue with that. Anyways. There are some important things to note. Number one is that utility function, that represents a preference relation, let's just write it completely, a preference relation is not unique. Why is that? It is simple, because if I multiply some constant on both sides of this inequality, some strictly positive constant, then also this inequality holds. So for example, I could have written, instead of ux greater than or equal to ui, I could have written 2ux greater than or equal to 2ui. So it doesn't harm. That means that this is why we are writing a utility function. So there is no the utility function. This simple x or y can be represented by a whole set of utility function. The condition is, whatever be that utility function, this inequality must hold. Otherwise, it will not work. Okay. So just to give an example of what kind of transformation we are talking about here, since one utility function cannot really is unique. So what we are trying to say is, so number two, we'll write, any strictly increasing function, some h going from r to r, is good enough. So what we're trying to say is that if for somebody x or y, then giving x utility of x to 10 and y to 12 will work. And again, giving utility of x something like 100 and of y something like 200 will also work. So as utility function, u and h both are good, because as we said first, that in ordinal setup, we are not interested in the exact number, we are interested in this sort of ordering. So as long as the ordering holds, everything is fine. And that is precisely what makes the utility function not unique. Okay. So every time when we start writing about utility function, we start with a utility function, because there is no the utility function. Anyways, now we'll need some assumptions. Okay. So that our structure becomes a little bit concrete. So number one is convexity assumptions. Convexity assumptions. Okay. Now sometimes this convexity is stated in English as a mixture is preferred than extremes. But that saying that is okay. So this is sort of okay, that if I say that a consumer prefers a mixture of two things rather than one of the things only. So that's what convexity implies. That's true. But in a sense, it has a very precise meaning. So definition of convex preference, definition of convex preference relation. So what is that? The preference relation R on X, which is our commutative bundle, is convex. So now we'll simply write sort of the definition of convexity in some sense. So it's convex if for all X belongs to capital X, and if YRX and ZRX, so if there are two bundles which are at least as good as some bundle X, then let us take a mixture of that. So alpha Y plus one minus alpha Z, this is where this mixture, idea of mixture comes up. So alpha Y plus one minus alpha Z RX. RX for any alpha belonging to close 0 comma 1. That means if there are two bundles Y and Z which are at least as good as some third bundle, then I can consider any sort of mixture of Y and Z, which is basically this one, alpha Y plus 1 minus alpha Z, because this bundle will be limited to the quantities there is in A, in Y, and the quantities there is in Z. So if Z contains some quantity and Y contains some quantity and Z contains some quantity, then this bundle will be a mixture of that. So if these two are independently, these are at least as good as X, then the mixture will also be at least as good as X. So that's what we imply by convexity. Okay, now obviously there will be a definition alongside of strict convexity. So definition of strict convexity, because remember we said that preferences can be constructed into two. One is strictly preferred, another is indifference. So this one basically talks about strict preference. Okay, so the preference relation R on X is strictly convex if for all X belongs to capital X, so that remains the same. And if YRX, ZRX, and Y not equal to Z. Y not equal to Z means, you may think that when we have written Y and Z, we have implied, what is the point of saying Y not equal to Z here and not here? Do we mean that the first one is written for same bundles? It's not like that. When we are writing Y not equal to Z, what we mean is this. Y is essentially Y1, Y2. And Z, as we know, is essentially Z1, Z2. So when we are saying, without mentioning Y not equal to Z, when I'm saying Y and Z, this means that Y1 and Z1 can be different, but Y2 and Z2 can be same. Or given Y2 and Z2 are different, Y1 and Z1 can denote the same quantity. So for example, here, bundles such as 3, 4 and 5, 4 are allowed. Okay. But here, when I'm saying Y not equal to Z, then I'm saying that Y1 is not equal to Z1 and Y2 is also not equal to Z2. So in a two component vector, by saying this, we are saying that quantity of each commodity in Y and Z are different. Here we're saying that, okay, it can be same for some commodity and it can be different from the other, for the other, okay? So Y not equal to Z implies, so in a sense, it will be the same thing. So we are writing the convex combination alpha Y plus plus 1 minus alpha z. And here comes the difference. This is, in strict convexity, this is strictly preferred to x. So px, this is strictly preferred to x. Obviously, for all alpha belongs to 0, 1. Okay, so here we are saying that if we make a convex combination, it will not be at least as good as x. Basically, it will be something more. So this convex combination, this mixed bundle, will be strictly preferred to x. Okay, it is because convexity or convex curve, if we look, then in general, convex means something which can look like this, but also which can have a straight line section. But when I talk about strict convexity, then that means there is no straight line section at all. So this is why when we are talking about strict convexity, the scenario changes from at least as good as to a case of strict preference. Okay. All right. Now, another one. So this one is axiom of continuity. The name suggests, the name actually tells us what I'm going to write. So the preference relation R is continuous on X Lastly, one important result is this rationality is necessary and continuity is sufficient. Continuity is sufficient of R. R means preference relation R for the existence of utility function. Utility function. So what do you mean by that? We are saying that when we have said rational preference relation, this setup is complete to have a utility function. There is no problem. So if there is an utility function, if we say that there is an utility function, then that implies that the consumer is rational. But however, existence of utility function doesn't mean it will have to be continuous. Or in other words, we can have a utility function which is discontinuous and there will not be any problem. Okay, so if there is an utility function, it implies that there is rationality. However, having a utility function does not imply continuity, but with rationality, if we have continuity, that means obviously we are talking about a utility function. Okay, so anyways. So we have a theorem which tells this in a more precise manner. So it says, suppose that the rational preference suppose that the rational preference relation R on x is continuous, then there is a continuous utility function. Continuous utility function UX that represents R. So if it is continuous, then the function itself, continuous basically means the function itself is continuous. So that's good, right? That's an added advantage in the sense that probably we can progress towards differentiation. Anyways, so some things to note again. So number one, so that what I was saying just now, so not all, okay. So not all utility functions, functions representing R, that is the preference relation, R continuous. Okay, so not all utility functions representing R are continuous. Number two, we'll be writing something, the clear idea of which will come to you much later, not now truly. So number two, so this says increasingness, that is a function being increasing basically, increasingness and quasi concavity. Increasingness and quasi-concavity. So what is quasi-concavity? Quasi-concavity basically means a function which is not concave in all of its domain. Okay, that's what it means. Now, not concave has a lot of options. So we cannot go further to that. We'll just say quasi-concave means not always concave. That's what it means. But it has a detailed mathematical role to play here specifically regarding the maximization itself. But the mathematics of that will come much later. Anyways, so quasi-concavity are ordinal properties of U dot. What it basically means is if I take an increasing transformation of U, then if U is increasing, after the transformation, the V will also be increasing. And if U is quasi-concave, then through that transformation, the V or something else that I'll obtain, that one will also be quasi-concave. So these two are ordinal properties of U dot. And as we said that, in terms of indifference curve approach, we are only interested in these two. Okay. So just to make it more clear, in contrast, the specific form, that is whether it is x1, x2, or whether it is x1 to the power something else and x2 to the power something else, or x1 plus x2. So the specific form of a utility function, or probably it is log x1 plus log x2, specific form of a utility function, is a cardinal aspect. Is a cardinal aspect. So for example, if I have u equal to x1, x2, and then if I go for taking log, so v equal to log u, then this will become log x1 plus log x2. Now obviously, the increasingness that is hidden in this function, or the increasingness that is hidden in here, that will not change. Both of this function will satisfy the idea of quasi-concavity. But obviously, the form of these two functions are different, in the sense that if I put 1 and 2 here, that will give a value which is very different from if I give 1 and 2 here. Okay, so that has changed. That's fine. But if we look at how the utilities change, if I change x1, x2, or if I look at how the order of values given different values of x1, x2, that order remains the same. And that is, it is that reason that we say that these two utility functions are basically representing the same preference relation. It is the reason that we started with saying that we deal with a utility function, not the utility function, obviously. But the background preference relation, it has to be the, right? So the rational preference relation has to be unique, because otherwise we will be confused about what we are exactly talking about. But given that preference relation, we can have a set of utility functions, all being increasing and all being quasi-concave. So Vx equal to, if we say f of u of x with f dash strictly positive, represents same R, that is preference relation, as u of x. Okay, so this is the general result. It also at times helps us to solve problem related to utility. For example, if I start with a function which looks like root over x1, x2, and then if I have to differentiate, then it will be a little problematic than if I consider now some v, which is sort of u squared, which will become x1, x2. But there is something that we have to be very careful about. And the point is this: in terms of utility, if I maximize this one, or if I maximize this one, it doesn't actually harm anything apart from the maximized value itself. Okay, so for example, in terms of utility, if I go with these two, I'm not really worried about x1 and x2. What I'm worried about is, what I have to be careful about is that the resulting value, specific value of v or specific value of u, will be different. But as long as we are talking about the preference of the individual, there will be no change. Okay. Now we have a small theorem again. So these list of theorems and sort of notes or results, they, what are they telling us? They are telling us essentially that given a problem, or given the consumer behavior, and given a consumer's preference, what else we can do, okay? And the assumptions, what they are telling us, the assumptions tell us what are the background requirement by satisfying which we can do all of this, okay? So this is again clarifying a previous point. So the theorem is a preference relation R can be represented, a preference relation R can be represented by again a utility function, only if it is rational. Okay. Then comes a set of assumptions, which are called desirability assumption. This basically means that it is not really required to assume that whatever we'll be writing. So it is not really required to assume them, but it is it's good in the sense of construction of problem and solving them, that if these assumptions are satisfied, then we have a far regular or more easily handling and more easily tractable situation. Okay, but an easier situation. So that's why sometimes these are called desirability assumptions. That means we will assume them, but it is not the fact that if we don't assume them, something will harm something. That's not the case. It's just that if they are satisfied, we have an easier problem. And we'll see to that indeed our task is becoming easier. Okay, so here also we have two different things. Number one is, so we'll go like this, definition of, so this is the assumption, monotone preference relation. Monotone preference relation. This is, as an assumption, this is actually quite strict. It restricts a lot of things. So the preference relation, again, the preference relation R on X is monotone if X belongs to capital X and Y double greater than X. Again, this sign comes from the idea of vector. Okay, so Y double greater than X implies YPX. So that means if Y and X are different for each of their component. So by this, what we are trying to say is that Y double greater than X basically implies this. If I take Y1, Y2 and X1, X2, then Y1 is greater than X1 and Y2 is also greater than X2. That's what we are trying to say. Okay. So these notations are coming from the idea of the fact that when I'm writing X or Y, we are writing vectors. From that we are, okay. So never confuse this UX with the UX that we had in cardinal utility function. This X means X1 comma X2, a vector. And there this X meant a single commodity. Okay, so these are different. Anyways, so it is, okay. Now, as I said, that this is a much stricter situation. It is not the fact that to work with consumers' behavior, we need such a strict restriction that to prefer. In other words, if we look at it, what we are trying to say is that if we have the fact that Y is strictly preferred to X, then we mean that Y is greater than X for all of its components. And not only that, it is true for every X in the commodity bundle. Okay, so that's a tough requirement, which is spread over the entire set. Now we will have something else. a different assumption, which is definition of local non-satiation. Local non-satiation, sometimes called non-satiety. Okay. Non-satiation. Sometimes it is also called more is better. But that's, again, that's a very, that's quite a simplification of what we are trying to say here. Anyway, so the difference is pretty simple. The difference is here this requirement is spread over the entire consumption bundle. Now, by using the term local, we mean that if we consider some neighborhood around the bundle, then this non-satiation will work. Okay, so we do not need the entire set. That means, in terms of sort of, what I try to say is that if this is the set of consumption bundle, what we're trying to say is X can be here and Y can be here. So if I have to have YPX, then this Y, we need to compare this Y and this X. And for that, if we are trying to say that Y is strictly preferred to X, we need to have that the amount of each commodity in this Y will be higher than amount of each commodity in this X. Okay. So what we are saying is that in local non-satiation, we don't need that. In local non-satiation, we'll be saying that if this is X, what we need is you take a small circle around here, and if in the higher direction, the utility is higher, the preference is higher, and if in the lower direction, the preference is lower, then that will do the job. I don't need to consider such a big distance. Okay, that's what local non-satiation means, that you don't need to consider such a huge distance, consider a very small one, and that's fine. Okay, so how do you write that? So the preference relation, so evidently we are going to write the same thing with only one change, that we'll not be writing for, it will be not simply writing if X belongs to capital X. We'll be writing something else. Or actually here we must write this, if for all X, this is some that we exactly, if for all X belongs to capital X. So here it will change. So the preference relation, the preference relation R on X is locally non-satiated, is locally non-satiated if for all X belongs to capital X and for every epsilon greater than zero. So this is where we are moving towards calculus openly. So, and for every epsilon positive, so you can get a sense of limit, right? By writing this epsilon, there is a Y, or maybe we write like this, there is, to make it more clear, there is a bundle Y belongs to X such that D of Y minus X less than epsilon, this D stands for distance. Okay, so this is a distance. So when I'm writing D of Y minus X, we are talking about, actually we must write D of Y comma X. So this is distance between Y and X. Okay, so D of that distance smaller than epsilon and YPX. So the same thing that we're talking about here, that if I have a huge bundle, let me choose some X. What we are trying to say is that for all X, that is for even for this X also, If I consider some epsilon boundary, and if I consider some y here, okay. So if I consider some epsilon boundary, and if I consider some y, even within that boundary, but not x, okay, I have yp x. Okay. All right. So I do not need this strict preference for all x. I just need to have one y, or what I'm trying to say is there will be one y, at least one y, in this circle of x, where y will be strictly preferred. Okay. And by saying that this distance will be less than some epsilon, we are saying that y can be as close to x as possible. That doesn't count as long as they are different. Okay. Okay. So now we said that monotone preference itself is a stricter requirement than this assumption of non-setiety. So we have theorems which says that. So number one, if R is monotone, R means the preference relation. So if R is monotone, then it is locally non-satiated. Yeah, let's just write this one. That is good enough. Okay. So with this setup, the assumptions and what we can do with an utility function, and the fact that utility functions are not unique, but they satisfy all of this. So starting from the fact that if it satisfies these things, we said that obviously the preference relation has to be rational, otherwise there will be no utility function. So as long as we are trying to draw the utility function, we have maintained the fact that consumer is rational. Apart from that, what we need is we need convexity. Also, if we have continuity, all is good. So for the timing, we'll be saying that there is continuity because we're interested to draw a continuous utility function. And as we said, that our desire will be fulfilled in the sense that instead of assuming monotone, we'll be working with local non-satiety. Now these are non-satiety. So now if you want to have some sort of term coming from economics, then for convexity, we can say mixture is preferred to extremes, which is kind of approximates this situation. And for local non-satiety, we have more is better. Okay. But continuity is continuity. It bears the same meaning that you have studied in mathematics. Okay, so with that, we can start a very important task, and that is derivation of indifference curve. We said that we are working under indifference curve approach. So unless we derive it, there is no way we can proceed further. So now that we understand that the assumptions of that we have taken regarding the utility function, we are in a position to derive the indifference curve. To list it again, we have rationality, which is needed for the existence of the utility function. Then we have convexity, which in simpler words basically means mixture is preferred. than the extreme or than a single good, only then we have continuity, which will allow us to make things continuous. And lastly, we have local non-satiety, which in some other terms is called more is better. Anyway, so given these four, we'll try to derive the IC. But before even going to that, we must first understand what IC is. So assume a two commodity world. So now we are clearly stating that even we have written everything in a vector notation, we are kind of restricting our world to two commodity. So for which X basically stands for X1 comma X2. You can easily understand that that can be extended to N, XN, but we are not interested for that right now. And for any preference relation R, U of X that we have written as so long, it stands for U of X1 comma X2. Okay. So typically, a utility function in our world, a utility function is three-dimensional. Okay. Now, the definition of an IC in difference card. Okay. So our objective is pretty simple. We don't really want to work in a three-dimensional setup. We want to work in a 2D setup. An IC is a device connected to utility function, which will allow us to work in a two-dimensional setup in Cartesian coordinates, so to say. So, speaking mathematically, IC is defined as the two-dimensional contour of a three-dimensional utility function. So it's something like this. If I have a 3D object and if I try to stamp that on the blackboard, then the stamp, the mark that it will create, it will be a 2D. And that mark is specifically a contour of a 3D function, okay? So without going into the complexity of that, in terms of economics, what you're interested is far more relevant to us. So IC is defined as the locus of, IC is defined as the locus of the commodity bundles that is our X1 comma X2 which derives the same utility or utility levels, sometimes we say that. So utility for the consumer. Okay. So typically speaking, we are, if this u is equal to u of x1 comma x2, then IC is basically that function where this u is fixed to some u bar. Okay, so basically we are taking a very specific value of utility u bar, and then given that u bar, we are trying to draw u of x1 comma x2, that is those pairs of x1 x2 which will generate the same utility value given the fact that the consumer is rational and the preference relation satisfy convexity, continuity and local non-satiety. So that is our task. Okay, and we are going to do that using a diagram. Okay, so that's what we are interested to draw. So if it is u equal to u bar, that means to draw an IC, we need only x1 and x2 because utility is fixed. Okay, so two commodity world. And u bar is u equal to x1, x2. This is something that we are interesting. Okay, so let us start with, let us just consider a point A where the amount of x1 is x11, the amount of x1 is x11, and the amount of x2 is x21. All right. Now, given local non-satiety, if we draw these, if we extend these lines, okay, so we try to understand where this IC is going. Now, if this is A, in this region, if we say this is region one, here, take any bundle. So in this bundle, let's say some A dash, okay, or just to clarify, let's say A upper bar. So on a bundle like A upper bar, X1 is higher and X2 is also higher. So on A bar, X1 is higher and X2 is also higher. That means on A bar, we have utility increasing. And that goes for any A bar which is included in this region one. Okay. So that means IC, if it touches A, then it cannot touch any point on this rectangle because here for every bundle, the utility is higher. Okay. Now, the opposite reasoning goes for this rectangle also, that here if we take a bundle and name it A lower bar, then their utility is decreasing because both x1 and x2 is lower in this rectangle. So utility will decrease. Okay. Remember, we are interested in that bundle where the utility is same. So we are saying that if u of x11 and x21, let's say, if it generates some utility u1 bar, then we are searching for that x12 and x22, the utility of which will generate u1 bar again. Okay. Now, let us take some point B here. Let's say here. Okay. Now, for B, we mark it as x12 and x22. Okay. So for B also, if we construct these lines, then this region will not come in the picture, and this region will also not come in the picture. So that means if I have to draw an IC, then that IC will pass through this region. Okay. And remember, for that matter, if we are on this straight line, even then, if we come take a bundle at this point, for such a bundle also, x1 is higher than what I have in B, but more is better. So at this point also, the utility is higher. So that means, let's just clarify, apart from this box, IC cannot lie anywhere else, in the sense that IC cannot be in this region, okay, because the bundles are higher. IC also cannot be in this region because the bundles are lower. So the IC can be here, it can be here and here. Okay, why? Because in these three regions, something is happening, which is that in this region, if I extend x1, I am decreasing x2. Here also, if I am decreasing x1, x2 is increasing, and here also. So both the commodities are not increasing or decreasing together in these three regions. So IC must be somewhere in this line. All right. Now, what are the options? So I can have an IC like this. I can have a line like this, and I can have a line like this. Okay. First of all, why I'm drawing these lines directly? I'm drawing this line directly because I have continuity. So I know whatever connects A and B is continuous. So that means there is no sudden break, there is no sudden gap. So it can be a straight line like this. It can be a function like this, or it can be a function like this. Now, what to choose between these three? So given these three, we use the assumption of convexity. So given convexity, we must choose the convex one. So this curve will not be applicable because this curve, which I just did, this is concave. Now here I have a curve where we have two choices, which is convex and a straight line. Why straight line is still there? Because straight line, in terms of convexity, straight line is weakly convex. And the lower one is basically, this one is strictly convex. So that's why sometimes, instead of saying simple convexity, we try to assume strict convexity. It's an assumption which rules out any IC which is a straight line. Okay. So now, if we assume strict convexity instead of convexity, then we can remove this straight line also, and we can say that this is the line which is the IC going from A to B. And now we can also extend it like this. We can have this IC coming as this, okay? So an IC which goes like this, where the utility is equal to U1 bar, okay? And this IC, given all our assumption, this IC is convex to the origin. Okay, now, so we have derived one IC. Now, we have said that there is this rationality. We have said that this rationality, it implies two things. Number one, it implies completeness. And number two, it implies transitivity. Okay. So the role of transitivity is that due to transitivity, we can actually draw a line like a curve like this, because we can compare, right? A and then some C here, some D here, and then B and then E. And we know that if A is indifferent to C and C is indifferent to D, then A is indifferent to D. And similarly, if D is indifferent to B, then A is indifferent to B. And since the utilities are same, the indifference curve's name comes from the fact that if A and B are on same IC, then A is indifferent to B. Okay. Now on an indifference curve, we have infinite bundles. So transitivity allow us to connect them, because as we said that if AIC, A is indifferent to C and C is indifferent to D, D is indifferent to B, then A is indifferent to B. So that's how we connect them. Okay. So that is how transitivity works. Completeness means that given any A, B, C, D, E, the consumer basically knows whether they are on the same IC or they are on some other ICs, right? Because completeness tells us whether the consumer is indifferent or a consumer is strictly preferring some bundle. So if they are indifferent, then that means they are on the same IC. And if there is strict preference, then that means the two bundles are onto different ICs, right? Because the utilities are not the same. Now, given this diagram, we need something else also. First, completeness tells us that although you have drawn one IC, there are several ICs, right? There are several ICs like this. Sorry, it cannot cross this quadrant, sorry. So there are several ICs going like this, okay? Because the consumer can rank any two bundle. The other thing that completeness tells us is that if A is in this IC, and there is some, let's say some G, which is on some higher IC, which signifies U2 bar, then we must know in which direction the utility is increasing. So for our diagram, we say, or we assume that the utility is increasing in this way. Okay, so in this way, the utility is increasing. That means if the lower one is some U naught bar, U1 bar, U2 bar, U3 bar, U4 bar, then we are saying that U naught bar is lower, U1 bar is lower than U2 bar, U3 bar, so on and so forth. Okay, so first we have drawn one IC. Then using completeness, we say that obviously there will be several ICs like this referring to different utility levels. And that gives us an indifference map. Given the map, how do I know in which direction utility is increasing? So that must come also from the preference or the idea of completeness. That if for the consumer, a higher bundle goes for higher utility, then a higher IC will signify higher utility. So by that we say that utility is increasing. And even if we say that more is better is present, then obviously higher IC will talk about higher utility. Okay. So these utilities, as we said, these are all utility levels. All right. So this is a complete structure where we have derived one IC, then you have constructed the indifference map. Now there are some, not really properties, but rather features that we have to be very careful about when we are working with indifference curves. So let's move on to the features of ICs. So just to clarify, we have drawn an indifference map with several indifference curves, which follows rationality, strict convexity, continuity, and local non-satiety. And the utility increases in this direction. Okay. So now we'll talk about some features which are not that apparent from such diagrams. So features of ICs and indifference map. So number one, by completeness, it means that the indifference map cannot contain any gap or blank spaces without ranking, because the consumer can rank any two bundle. However, remember just the fact that the ICs can be discontinuous, but as you have continuity also, as you have assumed that also, don't have that problem. Number two, utility functions are also called level curves, ICs are also called level curves, as different IC represents different level, or different ICs represent different levels of utility. Number three, which comes from actually this not contain any gap, that an indifference map contain infinite number of ICs. So technically speaking, what we are trying to say is that indifference map is dense, although that has a very different, very exact and different meaning. But for the timing, let us take this meaning to our heart, that it contains indifference map contains infinite number of ICs. Okay, number four, indifference maps. Indifference maps are distinguished based on a shape of ICs. Now that's trivial. If two map contains two different kinds of ICs, then obviously the maps are different. Number two, which sometimes we forget, is the direction in which the utility is increasing. Okay. So for example, in a diagram where this local non-serrated is satisfied in the sense, if more is not better, if more is worse, so if you are working with two bad things, for example, pollution and crowd, if you are working with that set of thing, pollution and crowd, then you don't like any of them. So the utility will increase in the direction of origin, where crowd and pollution both are reducing. Okay. So indifference maps are separated in given both these, each of these contexts. Okay. So that is why whenever we are drawing ICs, it is very important that we also mention in which direction the utility is increasing, because we can have two diagrams with the same identical shape of ICs, whereas on the left side, utility is increasing in this way, and on the right side, utility is increasing towards the origin, and these two will be completely different. Okay. So when you are asked to draw an indifference map, we must take care of these two points. Okay. Then comes one of the famous and trivial things, that ICs cannot intersect. ICs cannot intersect. Proving that is very simple. So if I have two intersecting ICs like this, let's just say this is point A, this is some point B, and this is some point C. Okay, and since they are two different ICs, so let's just say this follows some U1 and this follows U2, where U2 is greater than U1. Now, since A and C belong to the same IC, I have A indifferent to C. And since A also belongs to the same IC, which contains B, so from this IC, I have A indifferent to B. Now, this can be also written as C indifferent to A. So if C is indifferent to A and A is indifferent to B, then I have C is indifferent to B. But B contains strictly higher amounts of X2. B contains strictly higher amount of X2 than C, right? So that means C indifference B basically implies, this violates more is better assumption, right? If I say C is indifferent to B, then I'm saying more is not better, right? Because in B, if I have X1, 1 and X2, 1, and if I have C, then in C, X1 is same, but X2 is lower. So B and C with X2, 1 is higher than X2, not. But if this is the fact, and it's that, given that I am saying C is indifferent to B, then it is violating MIB. So such a situation that ICs, intersecting ICs, such a situation, it cannot occur. Okay. And from that, we can actually derive a sixth one. And the sixth one is that ICs cannot be shaped as a band, or other words, cannot be thick. Cannot be thick in the sense that I cannot draw ICs which will look like this, which will look like a band. Okay. Because in that case also, I have several points belonging to the same IC, right? Okay. So this also cannot happen. So when I'm drawing an IC following strict convexity, rationality, continuity, and local non-seriety, it will go like this. So this is ICs convex to the origin. Non-intersecting, each point representing only one consumption bundle. Given two points on an IC, consumer is indifferent between them, and there are infinite such ICs which constitute the indifference map. And in that indifference map, we must say in which direction the utility increases. For example, here we can say that, okay, the utility is increasing in this direction. Okay.